The development of the field of superconducting qubits over the last 15 years or so has really been quite remarkable. I think, frankly, had anyone in 1999 suggested that these macroscopic bits of metal sitting on lab benches and so forth might be competitive as elements in a quantum computer, qubits, with microscopic entities such as, say, nuclear spins or trapped ions, they'd have pretty much been laughed out of court. People simply almost took for granted that by the time you got to the level of this kind of macroscopic system, as they sitting there on a lab bench, full of impurities, dislocations, etc., interacting strongly with the black body radiation field, everyone pretty much assumed that decoherence is going to kill you stone dead. These are just not going to be competitive. In fact, it's turned out quite the opposite by now, as many of you will know. These superconducting qubits are serious competitors with microscopic systems as possibly the best elements in a quantum computer. I've quoted I've given you a reference to one very good review article on the subject by John Clark and Frank Wilhelm, who many of you know. He used to actually be here at IQC, and I think he's still a visiting member of IQC. That paper, of course, by now is somewhat out of date. The field has developed so fast. Somewhat more up-to-date one is again a sort of general review type article, Devorah and Shulkov, two people who have been extremely influential in the development of this whole subject in science last year. There are a number of more somewhat more specialised papers, review type papers, which I will quote in the next lecture. So basically I want to just handle the basics of superconducting qubits in this lecture, and then in the next one go into somewhat more technicality about specific designs and so forth. Well, as I mentioned, the superconducting qubits are a newcomer to the general area of quantum information and quantum computation. And I think probably the turning point came in the year around 1999 or 2000, when it became clear that not only so-called charge qubits, but also the alternative flux qubits could be prepared in a way which was which had sufficiently low decoherence to make it at least look promising. The advantages of these superconducting qubits with respect to more microscopic systems involved the fact, first of all, we've had a long experience of the behaviour of these Josephson systems at the classical level, and in particular the electrical engineering which has been developed in this connection is quite sophisticated, and so one didn't have to go back and do that from scratch. As we'll see, these systems are versatile, and there are lots and lots of knobs that you can use to tune them, and hopefully they're relatively easily scalable. I say hopefully because in some sense I think it's fair to say that no one has really built an array of qubits of the kind of complexity that one would need to make a realistic quantum computer. in a context where they actually are demonstrably performing quantum mechanical operations. I have to make that qualification because, in fact, as many of you will know, there is, for example, these machines manufactured by the D-Wave company, which do actually put together, I think, something like 100,000 qubits. However, it's not clear, or at least not yet clear, I think, that these are really performing quantum mechanical operations as distinct from some kind of classical operation. So I think the idea that these are going to be relatively easily scalable is, in some sense, a dream in the theory size, which have not been sort of totally proved in real life yet. Now, there's one very obvious disadvantage of these superconducting qubits, which was in fact the main reason why they were, as I said, which the main reason why they were not seriously considered until 14 or 15 years ago, namely, the decoherence is indeed typically much stronger than in microscopic systems. This is not at all surprising from the very nature of these systems. They are macroscopically, or at least mesoscopically, large. They're strongly interacting with their environments in a way that these systems are not. Nevertheless, it's turned out that the situation with regard to decoherence has improved very remarkably since over the last 15 years or so. In fact, as we'll see in the next lecture, we are approaching the point, the break-even point, at which the decoherence is low enough that they may viably be used as qubits in a real quantum computer. Okay, there are really three principal types of superconducting qubit. These usually go under the name of charge qubits, where in some sense the natural variable to describe the situation is the charge on a so-called Cooper pair box, a small superconducting grain. This was first demonstrated to be by Nakamura and co-workers in 1997, and then more spectacularly in 1999. The second type is flux qubits, where the natural variable is the flux through a superconducting loop. Those were demonstrated simultaneously by the group of Jim Lukens, Friedman et al. In SUNY New York, and the group of Hans Moy, van der Waal et al. In Delft in 2000. Finally, the phase qubit, where the basic variable, the most natural variable, is the phase drop across a current-biased Josephson junction, and that was first demonstrated by John Martini's group in 2002. Then one has, in fact, a whole set of qubits which in some sense are mixed. It's perhaps not entirely fair to describe all the things mixed, but they're certainly variants, rather non-trivial variants on the original ones. The earliest example of that was the so-called quantronium setup, which I'll talk about in the next lecture, but you have transmons, fluxonium, and various other beasts, which again I'll talk about. Yes.
So just about scalability.
Mm-hmm.
How
well do they, sorry?
Interact with each other.
With each other. Well, that's a matter of experimental design. I mean, you can certainly you can couple them both capacitively and inductively, and I'll try to talk about that in a bit more detail in the next lecture. But do you mean how strongly they interact when you don't intend them to?
No.
When you do intend them to. Yep. Yes. No, you can make them interact very strongly, in fact. Yes. As we'll see, various kinds of buffs have been developed in the literature. Okay, so let's start off then by talking about what perhaps is conceptually the simplest kind of qubit, which is the Cooper pair box. In that case, you have a bulk superconductor, which is separated by I've just drawn here a simple tunnel oxide barrier. In fact, as we'll see in a moment, it's usually a little more complicated than that. But they're joined with this Josephson tunneling junction to a small grain, or it's usually called an island. And the Hamiltonian for this system basically contains two terms. There's the Josephson energy coupling the phase of the Cooper pairs on the two sides of the junction. And then there's the capacitance energy. And, one usually calls it capacitance energy, but it consists of, first of all, intrinsic capacitance energy due to the transfer of charge across here. It also has a term due to some gate voltage that you may apply between the bulk and the island here. So the form of the capacitance energy is this. It's often written in the literature. Perhaps I'll show you the expression which usually often appears in the literature for this. We often rewrite this capacitance term as 2E squared over 2 times the capacitance times the number of the number of Cooper pairs on the grain on the island minus in G squared, where plus an irrelevant constant, where in G is if I remember correctly, it's 2EV over VG over C. I think I'm doing that from memory, but I think that's right. So the point is that you generally operate this device. Let me just make one comment before I go on to that. I've just drawn a simple junction here. In practice, you normally have two junctions, so that the diagram is more like this. And then the reason for that is that you want to be able to apply an external magnetic flux between them, and thereby send a sort of DC squid setup, and you can then control the value of EJ in that formula. Let me emphasize, in this at this point, the flux you're applying is just an external flux, and you're regarding it as a C number. It's not a quantum variable. Okay, so if you take this Hamiltonian, then it turns out that in the absence of the Josephson coupling energy, you would have this expression, which is a parabola whose origin depends on NG. So in general, it would be something like, these points corresponding to the possible values of N in this formula. Okay. In practice, one normally operates the simple charge qubit in the limit where the Josephson coupling energy, EJ, is very small compared to the capacitance energy. So in other words, you have EJ, typically EJ is much less than EC. That was certainly the case in the original experiments of Nakamura and company and in the first few years of the subject. If that's the case, then what happens is that the only point at which the tunneling becomes relevant is the point where NG is such that two of these levels are nearly degenerate. Okay? Yeah.
You have this expression for EC, but what's the expression for EJ?
EJ will be given by the standard expression EJ equals IC, which in general will be a function of the realistic case will be a function of phi times phi zero divided by pi.
Okay. So it's a function of phi when I have a DC squared?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And so you just regard phi as an external control parameter. It's not a quantum variable in this thing. So you can then adjust. You have obviously two knobs that you can put along this beast. You have the external flux through the DC squid, which will control the Josephson tunneling energy, and then you have the gate voltage, which will control the origin of this potential here. And generally speaking, you're interested in when you use this kind of configuration, you're interested in only the two lowest levels, and they form your Hilbert, two-dimensional Hilbert space, your qubit space. How do you measure anything in this system? Well, the normal measurement you do is of the number of grains on your island. And the way you do that is by coupling your island to a so-called singular electron transistor, or SET. Now, the theory of the singular electron transistor is quite a big subject in itself. It's been a very nice development over the last 20 years or so. The single electron transistor you could regard it in some sense as a sort of single electron box. That is, it's a grain, generally speaking, of normal rather than superconducting material, which will be which is sufficiently small that it is sensitive to individual transfer of individual electrons. And crudely speaking, the way it works is that because of the Coulomb blockade, the transmission of current through this device is going to be sensitive to the gate voltage applied to it. Now, if it was just isolated, of course, you could apply a voltage externally. When you've coupled it to your charged qubit, then in fact there will be a contribution to the gate voltage from the charges on the island. So it will measure the charge on the island. Crudely speaking, what will usually happen is that when you've tuned the gate voltage away from resonance, then this device will basically be will transmit no current under any conditions, and so it'll be insensitive to the charge on the island. And that's a good thing, because you do want to leave the system alone when you're not doing anything with it. On the other hand, if you tune the gate voltage right, then you'll find that for one charge on the island, the total voltage, that is this plus this, is such that you can get a current to flow, and in the other state it will not be. So it will be effectively constitute a measurement of the charge. Of course, in real life, if the island, let's say, is, I don't know, made of aluminium or whatever, the actual number of electrons on it is going to be huge. I mean, it won't be of the order of 10 to the 23, but it could easily be 10 to the 9 or 10 to the 10. But you're talking about two specific states which differ only in the transfer of one Kuiper pair to the island. So it's that extra pair which is giving the reaction.
So this bias voltage, this offset voltage that's generated by the island, is that due to the self capacitance of the island and the charge above the bottom?
Yeah.
So you have like a Q equals CV sort of thing?
Yes. Yeah. I'm afraid I've been somewhat, I oversimplified some of these diagrams somewhat. I've just put, as it were, put in a single capacitance that ought, in fact, to be extra capacitances to Earth, et cetera, which I didn't do. Okay. So crudely speaking, then you're in some sense your principal variable in this case is the extra charge, one or zero, or an extra. Well, sorry, two or zero, because you're talking about Cooper pairs, right? The extra charge on the island. And you try to measure that by a SED.
How does this relate to the diagram?
sorry, how does what relate?
How does this setup, the single electron transistor, relate to the diagram on the board?
To this one here? This
yeah.
one? Oh, well, okay, so you'd have, I haven't drawn things as it were to scale here. What I should really draw is, so if I'm really drawing things a little more to scale, what I would be doing is I'd have a large bulk superconductor here. I'd have my my Josephson junctions here connecting to my my island, and then the island would itself be capacitively coupled to the SET. Is that what that's on your question? Sorry? Sorry, which previous picture?
The previous picture you brought up, there was a ball and there was this square and there was the island. And the island is that small square to the right of the ball. Yeah, but there was a second ball.
Was it? Well, I think if it was, that was that was a misdrawing. Sorry. No. Okay. So let's go on then to the second. So some typical parameter values for a charged qubit. This comes from the original, the second paper actually, the Nakamura group, which is the one which was in some sense demonstrated things a little more spectacularly. So they had their actual superconducting sample, both for the bulk and the grain, was aluminum on a base of silicon nitride. And these are roughly the dimensions here. The ion capacitance is extremely small, at 6 attofarads, and that gives you a capacitance energy of something like 500 microvolts. The superconducting gap is about 250 microvolts. That's interesting because what it means is that in fact this is not large compared to the other scale, to at least one of the other scales of the problem. However, that doesn't really matter because under the operating conditions, you're not actually interested in the full value of EC, as it were. Remember, you've tuned, tuned your external, your gate voltage so that your two levels are almost in coincidence. And in fact, you only get a small part of this. Quantity here. So in fact, you would still treat the superconducting gap as large compared to anything you're actually interested in. The normal state junction resistance is about 10 kiloohms. And if you just assume that the standard Aronoff-Bohm relation applies, that will give you a Josephson energy of about 75 microvolts, which is sufficiently small compared to this one here. If I recall correctly, Nakamura and company don't quote an explicit value of EJ, but if you work it out from their normal state resistance, that's what we get. And the temperature of the experiment, remember that we've almost always implicitly assumed, or we're going to be assuming in this discussion, that the temperature, the thermal energy, is small compared to any of the energies we're interested in. So it's important to just check that is the case. The temperature is something like 30 millik, which if I'm not mistaken is about 3 microvolts, and that is sufficiently small compared to those.
Do you know how that island capacitance might be determined?
How it might be determined? Good question. I mean, I would think in fact that one could be reasonably confident in a theoretical estimate here, in the sense that, I mean, the geometry is relatively straightforward.
So you assume you have like some square plate like the island is?
Well, they actually show you the micrographs of this, of the island, and okay. So you can sort of figure it out roughly.
And then you assume that you have like, what, a conductor infinitely far away from the island? That's my self-capacitance?
No, well, I mean, the bulk has to... sure. So you've got the bulk and you've got the island. Forget about this.
Okay.
Got this and this. Okay.
Between those two.
Yes, that's right. Okay. Yes. So it doesn't matter if one of them is infinite. If the other one is small enough, they're still going
to
get it.
The capacitance of the island, you know, the capacitance of those two objects together.
Yeah. I mean, as I say, strictly speaking, I should have put the Earth in here somewhere and put investors in that, but usually, you know. Okay, so any other questions on this charge qubit? I say that's in some sense conceptually, I think, the simplest type of qubit. Okay, now we go on to the phase qubit, which is in fact the last comer to the era. In fact, it was invented rather later than the other two, but it's interesting to put in here. You remember that for a current biased junction, that is a simple Josephson junction subjected to a fixed external current. You remember we had this famous so-called washboard potential here, which is explicitly given by an expression involving the Josephson coupling energy across the junction, and then the an effective term due to the external current here. And you can rewrite this, if you like, in this form here. You remember there is this rather nasty question, which we've raised a couple of times, about in what sense you should treat these two minima as identical or not. Fortunately, under conditions of the operation of the phase qubit, this doesn't usually matter, because we're sufficiently close to lability that when if and when the system leaks out of one of these wells and starts running down the washboard potential, by the time it gets down here, it's running enough that any kind of interference effects can usually be safely neglected. If we are close to lability, that is, remember, lability means that the slope, we've increased the slope, which remember is proportional to I here, the external current, we increased it to the point at which we no longer have a metastable minimum here. And that takes place, not surprisingly, when I tends to the critical current. So if we're close to that, but a little below it, then you can expand the potential as a function of phi around its equilibrium value. And this time, I think I'm quite confident I've got the numbers, the actual constants right here. I have to sort of recheck these several times and recheck them with the literature. So you have a potential which close to the minimum is given by a simple quadratic plus cubic form with the coefficients given by this. And therefore, the barrier height, this is the important point to notice, the barrier height has a scale, not surprisingly, of the Josephson energy, but then it also has a factor of 1 minus I over IC to the 3/2 power. Also, you remember that the equivalent of the mass for this problem, the effective mass of the equivalent particle, is C times phi 0 over 2 pi squared. Therefore, if you work out from that the small oscillation frequency, it comes out to be this expression here. And apart from a numerical factor here, this is just the Josephson frequency of the unbiased junction, the isolated junction, multiplied by this factor 1 minus I over IC to 1/4 power. Now, from the results of an earlier lecture, you remember that in a quadratic plus cubic potential, there is a rather straightforward expression for the tunneling rate out of the ground state, more precisely for the exponent. The prefactor is a little more complicated, but the usually the exponent we're interested in. The the tunneling, the rate of escape by quantum tunneling out of your ground state is a constant times, which does act, and the constant does actually depend weakly on barrier height. I've left that out. Then you have the typical scale factor, the small oscillation frequency, sort of attempt frequency, if you like, that's multiplied by the WKB factor, exponential minus B, where B is the WK exponent, and it is given by 36 over 5, that's typical of quadratic plus cubic potential, that's the barrier height divided by H bar omega. Again, I would I would pretty much guarantee that is right. I've checked it many times, that number. then that then is proportional according to these two results here. That's proportional to 1 minus I over IC to the 5/4 power. So as I bring my current up towards the critical value, then I find that the WKB exponent will decrease, and therefore my tunneling rate will increase. For qubit operation, we certainly want to choose the value of I over IC so that the escape rate out of the ground state should be exponentially small. But now there's a critical point here, which we hadn't explicitly mentioned earlier. In this kind of washboard potential, assuming that it's indeed a valid description of the system, you would expect that you don't only just get a quantum mechanical ground state, you also get the standard excited states. And indeed, I didn't mention this earlier, but there is, in the very beautiful series of experiments by Martinez, Devereux, and Clark in the mid-80s, they did actually probe the existence and properties of these excited states, so by various kinds of resonance experiments. So we do indeed know that they're there. So let's... typically, there might be, under operating conditions, you might find 3 or 4 of these excited states in your potential well. But now there's an important point here. Of course, very close to the bottom of the well, the potential does look harmonic. You don't see the cubic term. But the moment you go a little away from that, you find that you begin to see the anharmonicity of the potential, and therefore the splitting between the second and first excited states is not the same as that between the ground state and the excited state. This is a bit exaggerated, but there is a difference there, in fact. And this is what, then, provided this difference is substantial, and we'll see that later that it is under operating conditions, you can use the two lowest states only as your qubit basis. Now, clearly, if that's going to be of any use, these two states do have to be stable over the lifetime of your experiment. So if tau is the typical lifetime of the experiment, then you need that the escape rate out of the ground state multiplied by this lifetime is small compared to 1, and similarly for the first excited state. In other words, there has to be negligible probability that either of those two states is going to tunnel out of your well during the lifetime of the experiment. On the other hand, you do want to use state 2 for readout, and the way you're going to do that we'll see in a moment, we're going to shine on radiation, which is resonant between these two levels, so that if your system is in fact in the excited state, you'll kick it up into the second excited state, and you then want it to be able to tunnel out relatively straightforwardly. So so you want that gamma 2 tor, by contrast with these, that's got to be large compared to 1. As I mentioned, just to be a little more explicit, to implement the readout for this system, what you need to do is to irradiate it with radiation which is resonant for the transition between these two levels. Then, if your system initially is in the ground state, that will have no effect because you're off resonance for that, for this transition. On the other hand, if it's in the first excited state, you will kick it up into the second excited state, it'll tunnel out, and of course the effect of that is that it'll start running down the washboard potential, and by the Josephson relation that says that the rate of change of phi is proportional to the voltage, that'll give you a voltage across your junction, which is substantial. I mean, it's of the order, remember that in the running state, the voltage across the junction is of the order of twice the gap divided by E. So. So that's a voltage of the order of millivolts or whatever that you can certainly pick up in your apparatus. So if we represent the Hamiltonian in the standard in the two-dimensional qubit space, which remember is just these first two levels here, if you represent that in the standard block sphere notation, then the Hamiltonian can be represented as that of a pseudo spin a half in some kind of effective magnetic field. Now, in general, the magnetic field might have different components. Evidently, the Z component of magnetic field with the standard in the standard representation is just equal to the level splitting here. So that's just H bar times omega 0 1, and depending on your notation, that may have a factor of a half or not in it. I think with my notation it should have. But then the question arises, do you in fact have terms in your Hamiltonian, or could you have terms in your Hamiltonian corresponding to the transverse components of field? And the answer is yes, provided that you add to the bias current. You remember you started off by just imagining you had a fixed external bias current I. Let's imagine now that you apply to, you modify that in three ways. First of all, you just vary the DC value away from its original value. And then and you also apply these oscillating terms, which are resonant with the 0 to 1 transition there. And then the matrix, I can't read my own writing here. The matrix element of the of phi, that your fundamental variable between the states 0 and 1 have this standard form. And so it turns out that in the rotating frame, that is the frame rotating with the resonance frequency for this transition here, then your Hamiltonian is actually given by this form here, where delta epsilon is the essentially delta I dc, and more precisely the let's go back for a moment. So your Hamiltonian is of this type here. Epsilon is your original splitting. If you want the extra splitting due to delta di, then clearly that is going to be d omega by di, which is something you can calculate. And the transverse components of your field, in fact, correspond to these extra oscillating terms in the current that you put in. So this is a nice point about the phase qubit, what we're talking about now. A nice point is that the Hamiltonian only looks simple when you've gone over into the rotating frame here. But NMR people do this all the time, so that's not something that should scare us. So typical junction parameters, this is from the original Martinus groove experiment. They used, in fact, niobium for their bulk superconductors and aluminum oxide for their junction. Incidentally, just about all, as far as I know at least, just about all, or a very, very large majority of experiments which have been done over the last 15 years with superconducting qubits have used as their bulk material either aluminum or niobium. I'm not entirely clear why these are regarded as particularly nice, but they seem from the materialist point of view to be preferable. So in this particular experiment at least, the area of the junction is something like 10 by 10 microns. That's in sort of standard Josephson terms, that's quite a large junction in fact. Critical current, about 20 microamps. Now the capacitance here is 6 picofarads. You remember that in the charge qubit experiment it was attofarads. So this is actually quite a lot larger. And what that means is that Now, there are various ways of defining a measure of quantumness. For historical reasons, I've happened to use here this particular combination here, and that comes out to be, if I can read it, 10 to the minus 8, yes, roughly. One could easily define slight variance of this, and I will be using variance later. What this does mean is that so long as I'm not very close to the critical current, then my capacitance energy is very small compared to my my tunneling energy, you know, EJ. So I'm in the opposite limit. So in other words, you remember that for the charge qubit, I had the Josephson energy was much smaller than the capacitance energy. Here it's in the opposite limit. In the original experiment, the Q factor of the circuit was somewhere around 300-400. Interesting point, the relative frequency separation, that is the difference between the two transition frequencies divided by the original one, is about 10%. So that's certainly adequate for to be able to treat things as a qubit, and not particularly since Q is this high. Very important point, external current, the bias current, was tuned such that the ratios of escape from the first excited state to the ground state was a factor of about 10 to the 3. And this factor, gamma 2 over gamma 1, that second rate from the second state to the first, is also 10 to the 3. That means that it's perfectly feasible to have the escape rate from both the ground state and the first excited state negligible over the lifetime of the experiment, while this is large enough to give you a readout. And in the original experiment, the fidelity of the readout was something like 85%. I don't recall why, what were the limiting factors there, to be honest. I do know that there have been theoretical estimates subsequently which indicate that you should be able to get up to something like 97% of that, which can hopefully be adequate for many purposes. Good question. I'm sorry, I didn't read the paper in sufficient detail to get that out. One speculation would be, of course, that despite the fact that you have these large ratios here, the escape rate from the first excited state might not be completely negligible over the lifetime of the experiment. That's only a guess. Okay, any questions or comments on that? Okay, so let's go on to flux qubits. Now, you recall that for a single junction flux qubit, in an external flux, phi external, the physical setup is that you have in the simplest case at least, you have a simple superconducting loop with a single Josephson junction in it, described in the usual way by a critical current and a shunting capacitance. For the moment, we forget about the resistance in parallel. So in circuit terms, that looks like this. So here's your junction shunted by a capacitance only. And you do have to remember that your loop does have a non-trivial self-inductance associated with it. So the potential energy associated with, now the phi here, phi is your dynamical, is now a dynamical variable. So we this is not the same case as we looked at in the case of the charge qubit, where the flux we were talking about was just some externally tuned object. This isn't your flux now is your true dynamical variable. The potential as a function of this has the Josephson term in it, which because of the condition on single valueness of the phase has this form here, plus this term here. And you see that because of the presence of this term here, or in fact for more general reasons, the flux is uniquely defined. That is, values of the flux which differ by n times the flux quantum phi zero really are physically different. So this is a different case from the case of the current bias junction, where we had some problems with the equivalence of the phase modulo 2 pi. The capacitance energy is, by the arguments we gave earlier, is a half C phi dot squared. Now, an important dimensionless parameter for this case is what's usually called beta sub L, which is this quantity here. And the significance of this quantity is that if it's greater than 1, then the potential can have one or more metastable minima. If beta is L is less than 1, then you only get a curve with one potential minimum. But more generally, that's true. And in fact, if you were operating, you remember that this, what we now call a flux qubit, used to have, pre-2000, it had the unromantic name of an RF squid. And in fact, if you're operating it as an RF squid, you want beta L in general to be large compared to 1 to have lots and lots of minima, and you'd actually sweep the thing up until you got to a rather high minimum, then it would escape. However, we're not particularly interested in that mode of operation here. So we're going to choose beta L to be close to 1, just above 1, only just above 1. And moreover, we're going to choose the external flux close to half a flux quantum. And then the interesting region of phi is close to, I was thinking something left out here. It should be close to phi 0 over 2 here. And in terms of the difference from phi 0 over 2, you have this characteristic form of potential. If the external flux is exactly phi 0 over 2, then this becomes symmetric. So again, rather similarly to the phase qubit case, you've got a potential which has a in this case a quadratic plus a quartic term, and then a linear term if the external potential is not exactly half a flux quantum, and the parameters are given by this value here. And that means that the difference between these two minima, remember this is essentially a flux variable here, as a fraction of the flux quantum, that's proportional to beta L to the minus 1 to the half here. So if beta L is very close to 1, then that's saying that these minima are going to be close to one another on the scale of the flux quantum. So you find that the small oscillation frequency is given by this expression here, proportional to beta L minus 1 to the 1 half, times omega LC. Well, omega LC is simply the resonance frequency which this circuit would have if you didn't have any transport through the junction. That is, if all the charge had to be carried, built up on the capacitor plates here. The barrier height for small deviations from half of flux quantum here is given by beta L minus 1 squared. So again, if we assume that beta L is close to 1, then in order of magnitude estimates, we can replace the quantity L minus 1 by this quantity here. And so it's convenient, in fact, to define a quantum parameter S by, it's essentially the same as the beast I defined earlier, apart from the square root factor. it's this factor here. And you see that this does contain H bar in the numerator, which indicates that when S goes to 0, you get into the semi-classical limit. So in terms of this quantity, you can do a straightforward WKB calculation for the tunneling. Now what you're interested in is, remember, it's a slightly different case now from the phase qubit case. in the phase qubit case, you had to worry about tunneling, but once the system had actually tunneled out through the barrier, it's essentially in free space. It's running away, and you can basically forget about any possible oscillations or whatever. In this case, the interesting point is that you may hope, and in fact find, that you can actually produce coherent superpositions of states in the two different wells here. And you find for the tunneling amplitude between the wells, it turns out this is for sufficiently small bias around phi 0 over 2, you find an expression for the tunneling amplitude. This is now tunneling amplitude, nothing to do with the bulk superconducting gap. It's given by this expression here. I'm fairly sure the factor of 16 over 3 is right, but I wouldn't absolutely stake my life on it without going back to the literature and comparing it. I'm fairly sure that's right. It's given by this expression here. That means that even if S is small, we can, in other words, if in some sense generically we're close to the semiclassical limit, we still get an appreciable tunneling by letting beta L tend to 1, which is, crudely speaking, the same as we got, and it's comparable to what we got in the phase qubit case by letting I go to IC. In that case, then you have a qubit basis, which, crudely speaking, would correspond to the ground state in the left and right well separately. And the tunneling amplitude is then, in that notation, if you take the ground state in the left well and the right well to be eigenstates of sigma z, this is going a slightly unconventional choice for the moment, but let's just live with it for the moment. Okay, so in that, with that basis, then the bias of the external field away from the half of flux quantum provides you with a sigma z component in your energy, that is a difference between the energies of the left and right well. And then you have a term in sigma x in this basis, which is the tunneling amplitude between the two wells. Now, of course, you might well want to change your basis, and later we will do this, such that your basis states are now the energy eigenstate. In those cases, these will be the symmetric and antisymmetric combinations. Yeah. I'm afraid you, in reading the literature on flux qubits, you have to be prepared for people to use either or both of these bases. Okay. So far, so good. What about the readout? The usual readout of a flux qubit is with a DC squid. So you have this rather odd situation where your system is a squid, a former RF squid, now redesignated as a flux qubit, and your readout system is also a squid, but of a different type. There is actually a not entirely trivial problem here. What does the DC squid actually measure? Well, now you see the sort of naive argument says that, what kind of coupling do we expect between the readout, the DC squid, and our flux qubit? The most natural form of coupling, which is sort of pretty much automatically provided by your geometry, is the mutual inductance between the two. So what that does is to couple the flux through the your qubit to the flux through the DC squid. The escape of the DC, the escape rate of the DC squid is a function of the flux through that. And therefore, at first sight, you'd say that, what the DC squid is measuring is directly the flux through the qubit. You have to be a little more careful, actually, than that, because you need to do a rather detailed analysis of the coupled system. And I don't. I've had comments from referees which indicate they think this problem is trivial. I don't think it's particularly trivial. In fact, one of my students is actually doing his PhD, essentially largely on this problem. When you, and it turns out that the situation is, in fact, quite complicated. First of all, you have to remember that although you may have tried to, as it were, try to just bring up some kind of external flux and put it through the flux qubit, you basically this mutual inductance between the measuring apparatus, the DC squid, and the flux qubit is going to be always on, even when there's no current through the DC squid. So we've got to allow for that when we set our initial conditions. In other words, we've got to make quite sure that we've cancelled any effect of this by some kind of other externally imposed flux in order to get zero bias here. So what we want is that, first of all, that it has to be possible to turn the measuring device off. That's not too difficult. All we have to ensure is that the external bias current through our DC squid is either zero or at least much less than the critical current. In that case, there will essentially be no escape. So the DC squid will be totally inert, and hopefully we can forget about it in analysing the behaviour of our flux qubit. Then when we want a measurement, what we're going to have to do is to turn the DC bias current through the DC squid here up to the point at which it becomes desperately sensitive to the total flux through these two. Then we're going to there's going to be a non-trivial effect of its interaction with the system, and then we can actually make a measurement. It turns out that it now you now have to worry about exactly how fast you turn up this bias current. If you turn it up fast enough, then it turns out you will indeed measure the flux through the qubit. If you turn it out sufficiently slowly, however, you're in basically adiabatic situation. And what you then are measuring, in effect, is the energy levels of the coupled system, which in the initial state was basically the energy levels of your flux qubit. So if you're going to turn your bias current up slowly enough, then you're not going to be measuring in the flux basis, you're going to be measuring in the energy basis. And I think this is something which has not been sort of clearly stated very often in the literature on flux qubits. What does fast or slow mean? Well, crudely speaking, it means that you've got to remember by turning on your DC bias, you're changing the flux through the DC squid, therefore you're changing the interaction energy, you're changing the bias on the flux qubit. How long does it take you to get to the point where the offset between the left and right levels becomes comparable to this splitting? Okay? That's the question. If that time is fast compared to h bar over this splitting itself, then you've essentially made an instantaneous measurement, you're measuring in the flux basis. If it's slow, then you've made an adiabatic process, you're measuring in the energy basis. So it actually is, the theory of a readout, I think, is not entirely trivial in this case. Okay, let's just look at I've just mentioned that there. Typical parameters, this is from not the original experiments, but a somewhat more recent one of Chiaresco et al., also the Delft group in 2003. Typical parameters, the critical current of the flux qubit around 0.5 microamps. That means a Josephson energy of the order of 200 gigahertz. Capacitance energy is about 7.4 gigahertz. So that means the ratio of the Josephson to capacitance energy is something like 30 odd. So we are indeed in, if you like, the fairly semi-classical limit. The tunneling frequency is low compared to these numbers, somewhat low, not all that low, 3.4 gigahertz. And again, they had to go down to a fairly low temperature, about 25 millik, small compared to any of these values. Remember in this context that that the equivalent of 1 degree is roughly 20 gigahertz. So 25 milli-K would be something like half a gigahertz. Okay, any questions or comments on that? Flux qubit. Okay, then we can go on to, an important question, which is the question of decoherence in superconducting qubits, which so far we haven't tackled at all. We've simply assumed that in all three cases we had a system which is described by a conservative Hamiltonian and therefore is not interacting or not interacting in any random way with its environment. How are we going to describe decoherence in superconducting qubits? Well, there's a sort of rather general scheme which we can use here. We can describe the system environment interaction, as we did in an earlier lecture, by the oscillator bath Hamiltonian. And then we can try to truncate it to the relevant Hilbert space. Now, for example, for the flux qubit, if the dissipation is due to something like the current, the normal current shunting the junction itself, then the natural basis in which to describe it is the basis of the flux or the phase, so the Hamiltonian is going to be a function of the flux itself and its conjugate variable, but also a function of the oscillator xi. And when we've truncated, now in this particular case, when we've truncated to the Hilbert space of the two states we're interested in, what we're left with is a Hamiltonian which is a function of the flux and its conjugate variable. That's the system Hamiltonian, which we've discussed. We've got the Hamiltonians, the simple harmonic oscillators, and now we've got this interaction term here. And you notice that the interaction term in the basis I've chosen, which remember is the basis of the flux, not of the energy, in the basis in the flux basis, the interaction term is diagonal in sigma z. Now, let me emphasize that that's not always the case. You might have, for example, a dissipation which depends on the phase difference across the junction, but on the other hand, you might be looking, for example, at a charge qubit, where that's not the natural basis in which to work. In that case, depending on your choice of basis, you could get these terms coupling to sigma x or sigma and or sigma y, as well as sigma z. But for the flux qubit, at least, life is straightforward, you can do this. And now again, it turns out that the whole influence of the environment, whether you're talking about dissipation, decoherence, or whatever, it's all encapsulated in this one single function, J of omega, which is this combination of matrix elements and densities of state of your environment. And the nice thing about that, as we stressed in the last lecture, is that that can be fixed from experiments in the classical regime. Now, one trivial thing we just might notice at this point, you remember that in my original oscillator bath Hamiltonian description, I had a term which was linear in Q, then I also had this quadratic counter term. Well, in this case, luckily, we can throw that away, because under normal conditions of operation, this is proportional to Q0 squared times sigma z squared, but automatically in your Q state, in your two-state basis, sigma z squared is just one. So that's just a constant which you can throw away. So I emphasize again that in the general case, you may get terms which couple not only to sigma z but also to sigma x and sigma y, and that's a very important one to come back to. Now, for practical qubits, you usually have weak damping in the sense that the quantity, which turns out to be dimensionless, quantity Q0 times J of omega is small compared to 1, And therefore, under those conditions, so this, I guess, should be, this is Q0 J of omega divided by omega, where Q0 is an appropriate unit of the flux quantum. That's small compared to 1. And so the effect of the environment then is proportional to Q0 squared times J of omega. You see, the perturbation is Q0, so the effect is Q0 squared, and again proportional to J of omega. Now, it's convenient and almost universal in the literature to use for the discussion of decoherence the standard NMR language. But now, remember that we do have to be a little careful about our choice of basis here. The in NMR, the traditional and conventional choice of basis is one in which you have, if you have some kind of fixed external field, that's going to be the overwhelmingly dominant determinant of your energy levels, and so you choose the basis, the eigenstates of sigma z, the spin along the external field, as your basis. Okay. So that means that the dominant part of your energy is diagonal in that basis. Now, the traditional NMR language is that d sigma z by dt, sigma z relaxes to its equilibrium value, which is not necessarily zero, of course, relaxes to its equilibrium value with a relaxation time, which is traditionally called T1. This is sometimes called the energy relaxation time, for obvious reasons. The rate of decay of the transverse component of spin is proportional to sigma itself. In some sense, the equilibrium value of sigma transverse is zero, so it automatically relaxes to zero with a relaxation time T2, where T2 is what we might call the intrinsic dephasing time. I use that term because, in fact, if we actually try to measure T2, just remember what the situation is in NMR. If you do a standard NMR experiment and you try to determine at what rate the processing magnetization, which you can say pick up in some kind of induction coil, you measure the rate at which that transverse magnetization decays to zero, it may turn out to be rather short. However, in a typical NMR experiment, you say, well, we shouldn't be too worried about that, because a lot of this effect comes from the fact that my external field was not exactly homogeneous in space, and therefore different regions of the sample rotate at different frequencies, they get out of phase, and therefore the total transverse component of spin decays. And you get around that by doing a spin echo experiment. That was a famous suggestion of Hahn more than 50 years ago now. You remember that you, in the spin echo experiment, you let the thing process for a little, then you flip it over, and the effect is to cancel out this kind of inhomogeneity. So that's a very well-known technique in NMR. In the case of say, superconducting qubits, obviously you don't have the degree of freedom corresponding to extension in space. On the other hand, you're going to actually have to do your experiment on a time ensemble. That is, you're going to have to prepare the system many times in the original state take your measurements and then eventually plot histograms and so forth. And so, since in practice, it's extremely unlikely that you started from exactly the same state, or certainly the same state of your environment, in these different runs, then the average between runs is going to give you an effect which is similar to the T2 star effect in NMR. So, again, it turns out you can, to a large extent at least, eliminate this effect by doing spin echo experiments. And having eliminated them, you then define T2 as the remnant, the part of the relaxation which is still left. And so we call that the intrinsic phasing time. It's rather straightforward to calculate both T1 and T2 by golden rule perturbation theory. Yep. Yes. So we have to be careful about whether we mean what we mean by that. Quantum mechanics, by its nature, describes ensembles. the question is, in this case, what are the ensembles? And crudely speaking, when you're talking about a superconducting qubit, the ensemble would be the ensemble of different runs. Since on any one, obviously on any one run, you get one specific result. So yeah, I should have got a had an expectation value, I guess, on this guy here too. Okay, so given this Hamiltonian here, it's now relatively straightforward to do a simple golden rule perturbation theory calculation and figure out what the these relaxation times are, or what determines them. And what we find is that the longitudinal relaxation time is given by this expression here, Q0 squared times J of omega. This turns out to get the dimensions right, fortunately. And then you have this cos beta H bar omega over 2. Now, generally speaking, you don't have to worry about, you can replace the cos by 1, because remember that when we're talking about quantum information operations, we're almost always working at temperatures low enough that KT is small compared to H bar omega. Yeah. So, so generally, under most circumstances, we can neglect that the cos theorem and just put it equal to 1. Now, T2, on the other hand, is a little more tricky. Half of the, T2 to the minus 1, the transverse relaxation rate, has some contribution from the same effects which gave rise to T1. In fact, there's a factor of 2 there. So T2 to the minus 1 is 1 over twice T1 to the minus 1. But then you have this extra term here. Now, where did that come from? The point is that when you're looking at the relaxation of the longitudinal component of spin, then the only coupling that matters is one which is going to change that longitudinal component. In other words, so it can't be, not anything proportional to sigma z goes away. Okay? So it's only the contributions proportional to sigma x and sigma y which come in there. And moreover, you're talking about transitions in which the system has lost a quantum of energy, as it were. That has to be transferred to the environment, so the environment has to have spectral weight at that frequency. That's why J of omega comes in there. For T2, on the other hand, unfortunately, things get more complicated, because T2 is basically telling you about the, in some sense, the inhomogeneity of the precession rate, or the fluctuations of the precession rate. That's going to depend on the modulation of the effective magnetic field in the z-axis, of the effective energy splitting, right? So that's going to, first of all, it's going to come from terms proportional to sigma z, not sigma x or sigma y. And secondly, very crucially, that modulation can be as lower frequencies are like. It doesn't matter if it's well below the transition frequency, it's still going to hit you. So in other words, you've got to take the limit as omega goes to zero of the appropriate form of J of omega. What have I got that there? I'm sorry, I'm finding it very difficult to read my own writing here. I've got T phi to the minus one. This pure dephasing rate, contribution to T2 comes from fluctuations of the relative energy of the eigenstates due to contact with the environment. Now, generally speaking, that's much more dangerous. Do I have the exact formula? Here's the exact formula for T phi to the minus 1. It's given by this expression here. And now you see we do have something rather dangerous, because we're taking the limit as omega goes to 0 here. So it's much smaller. We can be talking about frequencies much smaller than the transition frequency. And now it's not clear that this cough is going to be just 1. In fact, it probably isn't. It's going to be large compared to 1. So for ohmic, if we're talking about simple ohmic dissipation, where J of omega goes as omega, then it turns out this gives, the result of taking this cos into account, is that it gives e to q0 squared times kt. There, so fortunately, it does go to 0 as temperature goes to 0, but still, it's not necessarily going to be negligible at the temperatures we're thinking about. So this is one point at which we can't necessarily set the temperature equal to 0 from the start. We do have to worry about it. Now, unfortunately, ohmic dissipation appears not to be the norm for simple qubits. You remember that I, in an earlier lecture, I made the argument that you would expect to be able to expand your J of omega as in a power series in omega. And if you can, then obviously the ohmic term is going to be dominant. However, alas, it turns out that's not always so. And in fact, it seems experimentally that very often you suffer from things which are sort of just very vaguely and crudely lumped into the category of 1 over F noise. 1 over F noise basically these days means essentially anything you don't understand, which is going to zero slower than ohmic. It may be strictly 1 over F, it may be 1 over F to the alpha. But anyway, it turns out to be very nasty at low frequencies. And if in fact this is the case, then it turns out that if you plug it formally into this expression, it becomes divergent. What that means, of course, is that your original scheme of calculation is broken down, you have to redo calculation. There are some papers in the literature which do this, and one of two things can happen. Either you need to cut off at omega of the order of the inverse timescale of the experiment, which is clearly the lowest frequency is likely to be practically relevant, turns out that sometimes you find that your original exponential decay transforms itself into a Gaussian, so you no longer can define a standard T1 and T2 here. We'll just very briefly, let me just mention the principal mechanisms of decoherence in the three cases. In the case of the charge qubit, the most important mechanism of decoherence is usually fluctuations on the charge of the environment, which affect the effective gate voltage and therefore screw things up there. We'll come back to that in much more detail in the next lecture. A phase qubit, the principal fluctuations appear to be those in the in IDC, or perhaps more accurately, fluctuations in I sub C, the critical current. Now, why should the critical current fluctuate? Well, remember that we're talking about a physical junction, which is a real tunnel oxide or something like that. It's liable to have various kinds of impurity or inhomogeneity in it. And there's been considerable evidence, particularly in the work of the Martinez group over the last few years, that in a typical tunnel oxide barrier, there are so-called tunneling two-level systems, which basically correspond to an atom, or more likely in this case a single dangling bond, which can jump from one site to another. And depending on where it is, that may affect the critical current. So that's believed, in fact, to be one of the principal mechanisms, in fact, the principal mechanism of decoherence in phase qubits. In the case of flux qubits, the thing you most have to worry about is fluctuations in the ambient flux due, say, to the 60 Hertz background and things like that. As we'll see in the next lecture, we can get rid of some of these effects by appropriate advanced designs, which I'll talk about in more detail. However, one thing I do want to emphasise, I think this really is quite important, and I feel by and large the theoretical community at least doesn't take this sufficiently seriously. If you suppose that you have constructed for yourself a particular kind of qubit, and you wish to know how good it is going to be for the purposes of quantum computation, then the obvious answer is to take the scheme I've just described and measure the values of T1 and T2. However, crudely speaking, the typical measurements of T1 and T2, certainly anything that's at all similar to what goes on in NMR, the typical times over which this measurement is conducted is going to be the order of T1 and T2 themselves. Right? You're not interested in that for the purposes of quantum computation. For the purposes of quantum computation, you're not interested in the probability that in times of the order of T2, you've got decoherence of order 1. What you're much more interested in is whether for times of the order of a thousandth of T2, say, you've got decoherence of the order of 0.1%. That's, strictly speaking, that's a different question. And if you don't have a simple exponential decay, you cannot infer one of those results from the other. As I said, I think one really has to be rather conscious of this. And I personally wish that experimentalists, when they quote these numbers, would take a little more trouble in doing the experiments at really short time scales. Could make a difference. Okay, that's what I wanted to say. That's a very basic introduction then to superconducting qubits, just giving you the three main types and their main characteristics. In the next lecture, I'll come back to come to some of the more advanced designs and questions of what the actual operating scheme is, et cetera, et cetera. This does involve a fair amount of electrical engineering law, with which I have to confess I'm not personally that familiar, so you may find that I have to just refer to the literature for points in that. But this is all stuff that people who've sort of trained as electrical engineers know from the back of their hands. And a lot of it is.